The secret to a custom water cooling loop is to do what the pros do, and that is go in with a plan. In this episode, we're going to show you how to design a bulletproof water cooling system that looks amazing and works as hard as your GPU does. What's up, everybody? My name is Dwight, and welcome back to GeForce Garage. In the first 5 episodes of our Scratch Build series, we designed a custom chassis in SketchUp, picked up some basic metal fabrication techniques, learned how to apply complex designs to our mods using hydro dipping, showed you how to shine up your metal components using different finishes, and then walked you through the process of modding the heart of every gaming rig, the GPU. Now we're ready to add the last component to our Scratch build, a custom water cooling loop. Water cooling solutions can be as simple as an all-in-one kit, or a custom DIY kit, but this is GeForce Garage. So we're going to create our very own water cooling kit from scratch. But the most essential component of any custom water cooling isn't the kit or the materials, it's the planning. So that's why we brought in Lee Harrington of PC Junkie Mods to show us how it's done. Well, thanks for coming by, Lee.
Thanks for having me, Dwight.
So we're at the very end stages of our scratch build and we're getting ready to water cool. What's our first step?
So the first step's gonna be to identify what you're gonna water cool, because there's so many different options. You can do your power supply, you could do RAM, you could do a hard drive, GPU, CPU, You name it. Ron Lee Christensen was kind enough to paint the GPUs to match the build, So we're just gonna water cool the CPU only on this.
Okay, well, I know that every water cooling loop requires a block, a radiator, and a reservoir and pump. What specifically do we have on this build?
So this build has the EK Supremacy CPU block. It has a 360 radiator, a pump res combo with the D5 pump. So something that's really important for future maintenance, if you can, incorporate a fill port and a drain port. You know, not all systems you're gonna be able to do that because things get really tight once you put the reservoir and stuff in there. You know, when the liquid breaks down or loses color, you wanna flush that out and put in new liquid. And with the ball valve down here, it makes life a lot easier. You open that up, hopefully everything drains out.
Yeah, and it's pretty important to try to get your fill port up at the high point and put your drain port down at the bottom point.
True.
That way, most of the liquid comes out and it minimizes your
shaking
rocking.
It around, or dropping it on your head or whatever.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, so this one we actually had to put the fill port just below the CPU tubes because of the fact that the case gets slim up here. And there wasn't enough room to actually put it above. But I wanted to keep them in straight line because then it looks
nicer.
Aesthetically good from the front. So the next step would be to figure out what kind of tubing you're gonna use and fittings. So in this system, we ended up going with rigid tubing and we have the EK 12 millimeter fittings.
Okay, so we're gonna be using hardline in this. Now there's a bunch of different types of hardline. What are we gonna be using for this one?
We chose a 12 millimeter acrylic tubing.
Acrylic, not PETG.
Not PETG.
Okay, why are we not using PETG?
So PETG and acrylic have their pros and cons, right? Mm-hmm. So for one, PETG is a lot easier to work with. It doesn't chip, it doesn't shatter. You can't use the finishing bit on the acrylic.
Okay.
It'll actually just chip it away. You can use it on PETG. Now, the big reason I chose acrylic on this system is because of the fact it's an open air bench. I wasn't sure how PETG was gonna react with that. So that needs obviously an explanation, like your system, for example.
Right.
You like to run it dead silent.
Yeah, pretty close.
That means the inside of your case is really warm.
Mm-hmm.
So it's warm enough that it's actually making the tubing malleable again. So it's to the point where you can pretty much reach in there and probably bend it a little bit.
Actually, one of my tubes actually came out of my PC a couple of months ago.
Okay.
So that would make sense.
So what's happening is your temperature is reaching the point of reforming the tube again. Now the O-ring on the end is pinching that tube down to where the tube is actually popping out.
Interesting, okay. So we're gonna be going with acrylic for the ease of mind, or?
Yeah, I think I would say it's just because this is an open air bench doesn't mean it's gonna run cooler.
Okay.
Because now, like a case, you have fans, they blow air through, they move heat away. This system, the air is just gonna be stagnant right here, right? The heat's gonna rise, yeah, it's gonna go away somewhat, but it's not the same as having a bunch of fans blowing across your motherboard.
Gotcha, okay.
So I didn't wanna find out the hard way that the PETG is breaking down. You know, there's a lot of good things about PETG. Like for me, for instance, I run a system that I don't really care how loud it is. So it's good for me, you know? It's good for show rigs because it ships well. And most of the time at the show, it's so loud, they have the fans cranked up anyway. And then also for this system, I have no idea how the airflow is going to be back here. Mm-hmm. So it was just best to go with acrylic on this.
Gotcha.
So another thing to keep in mind is mixing metals when you're planning your loop and ordering your parts. You do not want to mix copper and aluminum. They create corrosion and electrolysis.
Good to know. So I noticed that you have a couple of pass-throughs here already drilled. How'd you go about planning your loop?
This one was a little complicated because we're going for the real clean look, mm-hmm. right? Originally, I think we were going to go with tubes up and over. But unfortunately, the back here needs to be removable in case you need to do some maintenance back here. And especially, you know, our drain port and ball valve and stuff is in there. So I chose to bring the tubes across and drill two holes for the pass-throughs here because okay. it gave the nice clean look. The tubes will be nice and parallel. And then you have back here in the back, we also opted to bring the reservoir on the inside.
Okay.
Instead of, we talked about maybe putting it on the outside here, but that kind of got away from the clean look. So we put the reservoir right below it, and that kind of simplified the loop. I mean, the tubing's obviously complicated because everything's so close, but in the end result, it'll be super clean.
Cool. Now, what's the actual order of our flow?
So the layout for the loop is from the pumper S combo out. We're actually coming out a little bit, we're going over, and then we're dropping into this T-splitter in the back. One side of that T-splitter is a 90 that goes into the bottom of the radiator. On the other end of that T-splitter is the ball valve for our drain, which creates the low point, which is perfect for maintenance. And then from the top of the radiator, we're coming out, and we're actually coming over a little bit and going up, and we're going to the first 90 here, which is the pass-through through the case. And it comes around to the side here. So this first pass through goes into the in on the CPU. And then the out of the CPU goes to the second pass through, comes around to the other 90, which is the actual back into the reservoir. And then at the top of the reservoir, you actually have we have a fitting here, which does this funky curl and goes into the fill port. So, and then what we already have pre-installed here is the drain port and ball valve system because of the complexity of the way it actually goes together with the case and power supply being here. There's no way we're going to be able to get it in after. Now that we figured out the path of the tubes, let's get to bending the loop.
Okay. Well, we got a bunch of tools in front of us. Why don't you walk me through what we have?
So first off, we have our 12 millimeter acrylic tubing here. I also have a Sharpie. When I do bends, sometimes I'll put a little mark so I know where to heat it up. Over my heat gun, and the mark will come off very easily with some alcohol. And then I have a miter box, and then I have my saw. This saw actually came from EK. EK has a little kit that comes with the saw, the bending insert, a piece of sandpaper, and I think a pair of gloves. Then I have my deburr tool, so after I make a cut with the saw, I take this and I deburr the edge, but sometimes when you have a bend, let's say you have a 90 degree bend right about here, this won't be able to go on there because it'll be rubbing against your tubing, right?
Right.
So I'll use the file instead and actually just do this number on it. You want to make sure you kind of deburr this edge, otherwise it's going to eat up your O-rings on your fittings. So next I have a little tub with some soapy water, which I prefer soapy water over oil because soapy water washes right out. Oil, not so friendly.
Okay.
Heat gun, PrimaChill bender, and I have a towel here.
All right then.
But this time we're not going to get into a full bending tutorial. There's plenty of videos out there like Jay's Two Cents, who goes really in depth on how to bend tubes. Right now, we're just going to get to work. We'll be right back.
Well, Lee, you did an amazing job. I really like this blue that you used.
Thanks, I like this blue too. There's only a couple other things left on this system and this baby will be ready to go.
Nice. And that'll be our next and final episode where you get to see the finished version of our scratch build. So be sure to hit that subscribe button down below and we'll see you for the next one.